Chapter 12. A Tourist Trap. With all her might, Orphy leaned over the seat and pulled her father easily out of the deep mud. The horse also was able to step back, and the monster revealed itself. "Looks like a bag of cloth diapers," Orphy reported, seeing them float to the surface. "Yes, but they were super absorbent," said Otis. Pyridine shook her head, and Otis lowered his hat over his eyes in embarrassment. A moment passed, and Otis blew the sound of a raspberry and flopped the reins for Midnight to proceed through the mud. They passed under the archway, signifying they indeed had found the old road, but it was now being used as a drainage sewer for the mission. Even still, it did not detract the goodbyes from conjuring a few memories. "Remember when we first kissed under the stinking corpse flower?" said Pyridine romantically, and trying to break her husband's unease. "How could I forget?" Otis smiled. "Where exactly is that spot again?" asked Otis, desperately looking around for the flower, thinking it may be the ideal spot to propose once again, but only saw a broken sofa where it once would have been. The mud shallowed, and Otis had to slick his moustache for several miles, feeling queasy from the mature, larger plants along the path that overtook the trail with their roots.
"I have to pee," said Orphy.
"You'll just have to wait," replied Pyridine. Otis saw an outhouse in the distance.
"Look there. We may be in luck." "Do outhouses always have teeth?" asked Orphy.
Pyridine, who was a master botanist, quickly said through the window, "We'll want to avoid that. It's a carnivorous plant. In fact, the old road had not been traveled on for such a long time, the carnivorous plant had blocked their path, taking the appearance of an outhouse. The plant had grown so exceptionally impassable that it added a park picnic bench to the opposite side of the road. Trappus tourus, she noted, commonly known as a tourist trap. Otis stopped the hearse. "Father," asked Orphy, "do you suppose this plant wants to eat us?" The father turned to her side. "It could," he said with a grin, "but that would put a damper on our trip." Otis stepped off the wagon to take a closer look. The shape of the trap at its center had its blades and the appearance of the outhouse door being open, and a toilet with hair and teeth positioned inside. The petiole of the plant. Pyridine knew to take caution getting close since the trap was the mouth of the plant. Unfortunately, Otis realized the only way they could pass it was with something it could eat. He stood for a moment in thought. Pyridine called out from the window, "Why not feed it one of the unknown clients?"
"Brilliant idea, P," said Otis reflectively. "We can't raise a dime to bury them. No one will claim them, but the tourist trap can."
Orphy climbed off the wagon and unlocked the door for her mother. Pyridine stepped outside and, with the help of her husband, pulled out a body wrapped in a white shroud.
"John Doe number 5, said Otis, looking eagerly at the shroud toward which they drifted. "You don't mind your body being digested over a period of weeks for our benefit, do you?"
The three waited for an answer, but when none came, they unwound number 5 out of his sheet and held him in their arms. Number 5 was wearing a golfer's uniform, a hobby he must have been fond of, had a heart attack from, and still had a grip on a polished hickory 9-iron.
"Perhaps we can hold him in a way that he would appear to be moving," declared Pyridine.
"Here," said she,
Take hold of his feet, and I'll take hold of his hands, and we'll both swing him in the direction of the plant. Pyridine pried the golf club out of number five's hands as they reset their position.
Okay, stand back, Orphy, announced the father.
Orphy climbed on top of the roof with club in hand and sat watching curiously while her parents began swinging poor old number five back and forth to build momentum until they finally said, four.
You mean five, Orphy replied.
Number five flew towards the plant, colliding with a heavy thud. The plant twitched, but did not go after the man. Unfortunately, number five landed too far for the plant to properly react.
Ah, banished, said Orphy. You missed the mark.
We will just have to trick the plant again, Pyridine chortled. The parents continued this unsuccessfully between John and Jane Doe's until, at last, they held the final John, also aptly named Number Two. They brought him before the plant. They decided to creep a little closer this time to set the position and quickly saw that the toilet or petiole mouth part of the plant was beginning to salivate as they approached, giving the effect the toilet was overflowing. Otis gave a sort of gurgle, feeling slightly ill, and stopped short, frantically wiping his moustache with a pterodactyl comb. Three times until he recouped, resting momentarily, he looked down in the dirt and saw a dollar. It would have meant very little, except for the face upon it he had remembered from somewhere.
What did you find, Father? Seeing her father pick up the dollar and bring it to the carriage.
Otis shared it with his wife and child.
I feel like I've seen this man before, although this dandy looks considerably younger.
Pyridine took the bill and saw the front was a cloaked young man with the increment of $1, while the back contained the word manifest and the name Lord Zenwick.
What's it mean? Implored Orphy.
Curious and mad, answered Pyridine. I have no idea what it means. Maybe it's a fraternity slogan of someone named Zenwick.
Maternity slogan? Asked the child.
Fraternity, she corrected.
Otis piped up, stirring a memory. You know, when I was a child back east, there was a Zenwick who had all the children in town work his paper route.
You sold newspapers? Said Orphy with a chuckle.
No, nothing that dull, replied Otis. I went house to house like a puppet, delivering similar dollar bills, with Zenwick's face printed on them. Just as this. And the words, a buck won't save you, but Zenwick can.
How dreadful. Did it at least pay anything? Asked Pyridine, astonished.
Not a thing, he responded, throwing the dollar aside. But for Zenwick, I suppose. When I tried to cash in these so-called Zenwick bucks, the bankers at the mercantile just showed me their own that they had received, and warned me of fraud.
All right, stated Pyridine promptly. Let's get back to our other leg pull.
Otis sniffed the air and could smell the plant was opening up by the scent of the John Doe resting so closely, giving him an idea.
Let's park the back of the carriage near the outhouse to make sure the trap doesn't grab one of us. After that, we'll tie number two up like a puppet. You and Orphy can control his movements from the top of the wagon. Clear of the trap, and when the trap sets, I'll back up the horse and wagon through the path.
So to begin, Pyridine took out her crooked needles, but soon realized she lacked the necessary thread. She pondered the thought, and after seeing her daughter's unusual veil, inclined to ask,
Orphy, can you see if Dorian can provide us with some webbing? To which the three hoisted number two up to the roof of the wagon, and Orphy brought the spider round number two and watched it swiftly respond with the needed threading for puppet strings. Pyridine stepped up to sew his hands and feet with her needle, while Otis proceeded to turn the vehicle around and slowly backed it up, being careful not to dismount the hitch. Pyridine and her child waited until it was in place before lowering the last John Doe to the front of the thirsty plant. Orphy held the puppet strings like reins of a horse and followed her mother's lead. "Steady," guided P. "Keep your balance. We don't want you to fall in with him." Otis and Orphy chuckled as Pyridine rolled her eyes, watching them dance cadaver number two in front of the trap, providing a sort of enthusiasm to see the outhouse, while Otis imitated his voice. "Oh, thank heavens! I have been on the road all day, and after eating those nachos, ooh, I could use a toilet." The plant's mouth twitched, and Pyridine continued with her instructions, reminding Orphy, "When the trap takes the bait, don't forget to let go." It was then the trap lifted its roots off the path and slurped up number two, yanking the puppet strings and Orphy with it, who indeed forgot to let go. Thankfully, her new pet Dorian had fastened around her with its webbing and held her down like a seatbelt. Orphy let go. Knock, crash, burp went the outhouse, and it made so much clatter digesting number two that they were much more terrified that it might regurgitate him, so they flattened themselves out onto the wagon, and Otis turned round the carriage in a rush and fled past the plant. "Ha ha, and we're off."